Greetings. Welcome to another edition of Celebrate Life. My name is Wayne Braverman. It is a pleasure to be able to spend this time with you. I have with me two special guests. One of them is my friend Scott Galbraith.
How are you?
And I also have calling us, or we actually called him, on the West Coast, Sean Justice. Sean, thank you for taking time to be with us here on the much colder East Coast.
Glad to be here, Wayne.
Yeah, you are in Oregon at the moment, yes?
I am. We are in Central Oregon right now at a family cabin, enjoying the winter weather here, actually.
Well, and it's good to spend a vacation out there in its beautiful country.
Thank you.
The reason why we have Sean and Scott with us today is because they have produced a movie. The name of the movie is The Reconciler. Mm-hmm. And it's, Scott, when's it coming out?
Well, it's being re-released in January. Sean, do you know what the date is?
I don't have the specific date. That'll be on DVD, but it also has been recently added to a couple of one streaming site and then another VOD site, which people can get it at.
Yeah, you can see it on Pureflix, for example, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And yeah. What's the plot of the movie? What's this about?
The plot of the movie, in a nutshell, is about a mysterious guy called the Reconciler. The movie starts, I play a character named Ed, and me and a guy named James, we wake up in a room having no idea how we got there. We're in a warehouse room, we're locked in the room, we can't get out. And eventually we discover that also hidden in the room is his brother, who he hasn't talked to in a long time. And it's at that point you find out that I am the reporter who's been doing stories on a character called, on a mysterious guy called the Reconciler, who basically snatches up people who are not talking and he locks them in a room until they do talk.
Mm-hmm. What's the intended audience for the movie?
The intended audience for the movie is, it's a faith-themed film.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And also you're aiming at a general audience.
Yes. Yes, I would say that's right. Right, Sean?
Yeah, there is that. You know, there's a lot of themes in it that really resonate with everyone. Really, I've had people that have seen the movie that have been really touched. You know, a lot of people think that they have irreconcilable differences with others, yeah. And you know, come to find out, if they just come, you know, together and talk, and you know, in our case, you know, the fun element is that they're forced to come together and talk, or else they won't get out of where they're at. And, you know, it has really caused a lot of the viewers of the movie, people with faith and just a general audience, you know, it touches them and it gets them to really think through their own estrangement of relationships or, you know, people they may have held a grudge against to maybe rethink that relationship.
It sounds like it's a movie about forgiveness, about communication, and about healing through faith.
Very, very much. And, you know, I think the principles of it can apply to people of faith or you know, people not of faith, really.
Mm-hmm. The way you and Scott came together is fascinating, too. You'd never met before this movie, correct?
Well, yes and no. What ended up happening was is that I had actually had an idea for another film that I had done as a stage play at my church. Mm-hmm. And one of the people that I was talking to, he's a very private person, so I'll just tell you his first name here on air. His name was Barry. And Barry was a Facebook friend of mine who I had never met. We had a few phone conversations. And he said, you know, Scott, the story was a movie called The Twin Master, which was about twins. And Barry said to me, Scott, you should try that. If you're looking for somebody to help you make the film, because I am not a producer, I am not a director, I am a guy with an overactive imagination, mm-hmm. who likes to act in his own stuff. That's about, my background is mostly is mostly theater.
Mm-hmm.
And what Barry said to me was, is one guy that you should try if you're looking for a producer or director is this guy named Sean Justice in the Oregon area. He's a Christian, he's a filmmaker, and he's a twin himself. So he might actually be interested in doing this. And so I emailed him my first draft of the script, and I'll never forget the Christmas after the first year we met, which I believe was, what, 2010, Sean, somewhere around there?
I think so.
Yeah, around 2010. He sent me back a copy of Twin Master that had been, like, rewritten by him and was 10 times better. And so this started a journey of us that we're actually still on trying to get this movie made. And then, at that point, we still had not met each other in person. We had logged hours on talking to each other on Facebook, talking to each other on the phone, but had never met in person. And then something ended up happening that I'll let Sean tell you about in 2012 that kind of changed the course of the direction that we were going.
It definitely changed the course of where you were going and basically your lives.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, it was the summer of 2012. I have four kids, and my wife and I, and we sent our two oldest sons off to summer camp in 2012. They're, I'm trying to remember, like 15 and 17, respectively. And Josh was the oldest, and Caleb was the second oldest. He was, had just turned 15. And we sent them on Sunday, and on Monday, about 2:30, I get a phone call from the youth pastor of the church we're going to, and he was one of the leaders, and he just very frantically told me that something had happened to Caleb, and then he broke down in tears, and I thought, boy, this is pretty serious. And I said, well, just, you know, Ricky, just pray. And as the events unfolded, we found out that, and headed to the camp ourselves, we found out that Caleb and was led by a counselor around a very dangerous set of waterfalls, and they both perished in the process. And, you know, it was definitely a shock, and we didn't expect it. But we knew Caleb, and he was a very resilient, very spiritual, his faith was very important to him, and we're, you know, proud of him. We had no regrets, and we just reflected, and as we were driving up to the falls, about his life, and we pretty well, you know, they hadn't confirmed that he had passed, but we just had this knowledge or premonition that, you know, he was no longer with us. He was heaven's side, I like to say. And as the whole thing unfolded, we were just greatly at peace by the time we got to the camp. And it was amazing because the other kids there and the counselors, I mean, the camp was just in tears and it was so funny because we were actually more of an encouragement to the people there, it seemed, than the people were trying to be to us. And it was very poignant. It was pretty amazing. And but as the process went on, we ended up learning a bit more about what had happened and that there was some responsibility to be taken, some bad decisions. And we decided to pursue the insurance money that was there. And but what we wanted to do with that was to honor Caleb and honor his memory, not only within our family, but in general. And so one of the things that I called Scott, and I just had this piece about it, was to, you know, as a filmmaker, of course, I love to tell stories. And I thought, you know, why don't we use, you know, some of the funds to, you know, I hadn't made a film in a decade or more. And even though I'd written many screenplays, I wanted to start out with a film that we could, you know, start small, per se, and work our way up back into it. And I knew Scott had written a play, I think back actually a couple of years before, right around the time Caleb passed, and it was called The Reconciler. And it had limited locations, you know, limited cast. And I said, you know, maybe that'd be a cool little film to kind of start with and grow from there. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of how the Reconciler came about. And we're able to, you know, put the funds into it. Caleb is actually named as the sole executive producer of the film and, you know, helping preserve his legacy as well. And the fact that, you know, Caleb was very, you know, committed to his faith and really just had these amazing insights and such. And so the film, you know, I think definitely reflects even his heart in the whole. So that's kind of the story behind how The Reconciler came about being made.
Do you ever feel that Caleb's with you?
You know, I we don't really take that perspective. We may mm-hmm. feel like he's, you know, privy to what's going on Earthside, you mm-hmm. know, with us. But I wouldn't say that we'd feel his presence per se.
mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Now this movie also has a very interesting person in it. A pro wrestler's in this movie.
Yes, Roddy Piper. And,
yeah, I had worked with Roddy. Hold on, real quick. I had to clear my throat. you know, I had between you know, films, I did a lot of corporate and broadcast video work as well, and I had worked with Roddy a couple of times on projects. He lived in the Portland, Oregon area, and when it came time to do this movie, my co-producer suggested Roddy, and it was special to Roddy too because he, when Caleb passed, he found out through my friend and contacted me and just poured his heart out and felt really he had, you know, several kids of his own, his oldest son, and you know, just for people to imagine, you know, their own child going through the, you know, drowning, I think really touched a lot of people. Another good friend of mine that actually Scott introduced me to was Michael Joyner, who's a well-known Christian comedian and actor, and he kind of had the same, you know, feelings mm-hmm. and just reached out to me. But with Roddy, it was really, it touched my heart because, you know, he's known as kind of the bad guy or the, you know, the tough guy.
And yeah. The villain.
That his, yeah. his, that's his persona that he, you know, portrayed in his wrestling years. But in actuality, he is just one of the sweetest guys that you want to know. And even when he was on set, he was just very complimentary and very, he actually took to Joshua, who, you know, is the older brother, the firstborn, and just really, you know, comforted him as well. So it was a really special, special thing that Roddy was involved.
You talked about how he even got into pro wrestling a little bit. That was a fascinating story for me.
It is. You know, Roddy was definitely a man of faith. We had very interesting conversations on the movie set and before that, where he would talk about even when he got into wrestling, he got into it through the invitation of a priest. And they had a local wrestling program, I think at the diocese or at the parish. And Roddy was kind of living a pretty rough life as a kid, and it really dialed him in. It got him, you know, passionate about something, but the whole element of the spiritual side, you know, came with that through the involvement of the priest and helping give him direction. So yeah, it was his spiritual side was from the beginning.
Scott, is this what you imagined that this would actually become a movie like this, or did
no,
you just?
It's kind of weird. It's like I said, I had written the first script based on a play that I had done, The Twin Master, a couple of years before that, and we were a couple of years into getting that made when this whole thing happened. And Sean, I think I've told you this before. You know, Sean basically said, yes, I will help you with Twin Master when I was getting every other door slammed in my face as mm-hmm. far as people who I was trying to pitch the idea to. And, you know, you always wonder, you know, how bad things happen to people who you don't feel deserve it. It's the old cliche, why do bad things happen to good people? And I can just remember on July 9th, I was calling up Sean about something random. And when he told me what had happened to Caleb, I had felt like someone had just, you know, hit me right in the guts, because I was like, you know, Lord, after I haven't even met this guy and he seems to be somebody who just genuinely wants to help people and took a chance on a crazy kid from Boston, took the time to rewrite his script when he hadn't even met him. And if there was anybody who I could think of who didn't deserve a tragedy like this more, it was Sean.
Mm-hmm.
And to be honest with you, I knew that his priority was going to be his family, and I'm embarrassed to admit that for a brief moment, I honestly thought that, okay, it's not going to happen, Lord. And I can't be ungrateful for that. You know, Sean's priorities, his family, who knows what's going to happen in the next couple of years. And I actually didn't call him for a couple of weeks because I didn't want to, you know, get him at the wrong time or whatever. But the weird thing is, I was actually directing the stage play version of Reconciler at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And Reconciler, Twin Master was a storyline that I had done a ton of research on, really put the story together and thought it out. Reconciler was one of those ideas you have and you go to when you don't have anything else. It was literally, okay, what's the simplest thing I can do? Three people talking in a locked room.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So I brought that up. And if someone had reached back to me in 2012 and said to me, oh, by the way, this tragedy that your friend has gone through is the very thing that is going to make what you guys have been pursuing all this time come true, I never would have believed. If someone had told me Reconciler was going to be a movie before Twin Master, I never would have believed it either.
You thought it'd be the other way around.
Yeah, I know. I thought it would be, yeah, exactly. And the truth, and just like he did with Twin Master, it was one of the ways that Sean and I, one of the reasons why Sean and I think make such a good writing team is because we are both the strengths for the other's weaknesses.
Mm-hmm.
And Sean has told me several times that I'm good at coming up with plots and I'm good at coming up with story structure.
Yep.
But Sean has more life experience than I do and is better at writing dialogue that flows better than I do.
Mm-hmm.
So the procedure that we've kind of gone through is he has let me write the first draft of the script, and then he takes my lame piece of material and turns it into a piece of gold with great flowing dialogue. He actually added a whole other storyline to Reconciler that wasn't there, because my original play was only about something like 45 minutes to an hour long, and that's not screenplay length.
No.
And no matter how hard, we basically emailed it back and forth for like a month or two, trying to get it longer, trying to stretch it out. And finally Sean said, I think we need another storyline here.
Mm-hmm.
And so he added there's a secondary storyline with do you have the cover there? Do you have the,
yep,
yeah,
I'm Sherry, right here.
Sherry Morris, who's on the cover there, who everybody knows from the Book of Ruth. She was actually a major find because she's kind of known in the market that we're pitching this is, which is the faith theme market. Mm-hmm. She came on, what was it, through Byron Jones, Sean?
Yeah, Byron Jones, who's been in the faith-based films for quite a long time in the marketing side.
Yeah.
Kind of a legend.
Yeah. So he introduced her to Sean, mostly. I met her only once. And Sean came up with a whole secondary reporter storyline that coincides with the guys being locked in the room in order to make the film feature length. Mm-hmm. So
is the faith-based movie business, is that something that's growing, or did that reach a peak when Fireproof and some of the movies around that era not too many years ago came out?
Well, I've just observed that you could find them a whole lot easier than you could many years ago. Like today you turn on demand and you can find everything from Fireproof to Courageous to Risen and mm-hmm. stuff. So I definitely think what Sherwood Pictures did with their movies, as well as the success of God's Not Dead, have both been game changers.
Yep.
But I don't have any, it's just what I've been observing. I don't have any data to support that. Sean, I don't know what you'd say about that.
Yeah, they're definitely growing. You know, Hollywood films, are great and entertaining, but I think the people of faith, because their faith is so important to them, would love, they were very interested in seeing stories that they could identify with even more than just, you know, general elements of psychology. You know, you have the spiritual elements. And so I think that's why the demand has gone up, and you have more and more titles being produced, but you also have the avenue for them to be out there in distribution as well. And you've even seen, you know, probably, I mean, if you took Hollywood today and how many, you know, faith-based films or faith-themed or faith element, whatever you want to call it, you see a lot more of that now than you did, say, 20, 30 years ago, where Hollywood just felt, well, you know, church should be in church, or the spiritual elements should be, you know, come from your pastor, not from Hollywood. And I just don't think that's the case. I think, you know, as people of faith, we live, you know, outside of church 6 days a week in our own lives. So, you know, I definitely think there is a pent-up demand, and you'll see that in the research, you know, for films that dealt with issues that people of faith, you know, it was more, that were more important to them, or were important to them. And so, you know, to have these films come out, you know, from the Kendrick brothers and from others, you know, that are more available in the mainstream venues, I think it's a market, and some are done well, some are not done well. We know we've seen that.
That's true in any genre.
It's definitely a growing market, and there's an audience there that wants to see these kinds of films.
There is one thing that I would kind of just add to that. You know, you had mentioned, you know, Fireproof, like from the Kendrick brothers and stuff like that, and all their movies. There's one thing that I heard Alex Kendrick say once in an interview that I will never forget, and I think it's a testament to one of the reasons why their films have been so successful. Mm-hmm. They said lots of times when they're trying to figure out what their next film is going to be, usually it's Alex who will, like, come up with an idea for a scene or come up with an idea for a story. Yeah. And then he'll get together with Steve and his brother and say, okay, now let's give this to the Lord and figure out what he wants to do with it. Now, I am by no means on air to... I mean, Sean said, you know, some films are done well, some films are not done well. I have always thought that the Christian films or the faith-based films that do better are the ones that have a story, that have a message, rather than have the message be the story.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? There's just... You look at the film and you go, okay, this film was a vehicle to get a message across that someone in the Christian community wanted to say. Like, for, and the truth is, one of the reasons why both of these, the idea that Sean and I have already made and the other ones that we're trying to get made, two of them were plays that I had done originally. One of the reasons why I wrote plays was because I got tired of going into my church library and opening up the drama books, and every skit is person one talking to person two on the street about spiritual concept A, B, or C.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm looking at this and I'm going, you know, God gave us imaginations. Let's use them, for crying out loud. And one thing that I think Sean would agree, we want to make films that maybe are a little bit outside of the box, as opposed, I mean, like, for example, Sean's working on a film right now that you want to tell him what it's about?
It's a faith-based Russian mafia movie.
There you go.
Yeah. Russian mafia is such a good theme these days because it seems to be prevalent
Right.
Maybe I won't go down that road quite.
Yeah, yet, I mean, but even the movie that we made, Reconcile.
The Narrow Road. So.
Oh, The Narrow Road, yes.
The Narrow Road, yeah. And what's the plot of that movie?
Well, you know, ultimately the theme or the element is that there is a character who, you know, seems to be well-adjusted, and he has good friends, and he has... He loves his mother, and he just, you know, seems like a good guy. And you get into his story a little bit to the point where he actually doesn't like to tell about his past to people, or he generalizes, or he defers. And we come to find out through an accidental encounter where he's in the coffee shop with his buddies, and in walks a person out of his past, his ex-girlfriend, who is from Ukraine. And he goes over and talks to her and finds out, and it basically is revealed that he was in the Russian mafia in his past life. And and I don't mean past life as in, you know, reincarnation, before he came to faith in Christ. And he went through prison, and people helped him, and but the people from his past life find out, the mob boss's son, that he is now living here in the Pacific Northwest, and wants to bring him back into the family, and because he has use for him. And so the guy has a choice, especially when his one of his good friends is an FBI agent and suggests to his friend that they've been trying to bring down this illegal chop shop car ring for a number of years, and if he went back in as a CI, a confidential informant, that he could help them. And so he's faced with that choice of, do I get back into my old life, and do I even want to go there or not? So there's a lot of intrigue. There's a lot of moral choices that he has to make, and it's just kind of a fun ride of a film. We have Ferraris and Porsches and car chases and some gunplay in it, and even a couple of fight scenes. So,
and let's not forget the
film, but it also, deals with faith elements too.
Mm-hmm. Let's not forget one other attribute of the film is the super talented Xander Steele, who was actually in Reconciler. And he went on to, him and Sean clicked very quickly, and they went on to do this film. And we're hoping to use him in a film in the future that we want to do as well. So
I actually have a dumb movie question for you.
Oh, sure. Go ahead.
And Sean will know the answer to this. How do you do car chases on movies? Do you actually like drive around and crash into things, or how does this
not
happen?
My area of expertise, like I said, I know how to write an act.
I've always wondered about it, but Sean will know the answer to this.
Well, it's very meticulous. Being that it's still a low budget film, you know, we don't have the millions of dollars to flip cars and crash cars and do all those fun stuff, but the way we did ours is just meticulous, multiple angles. We use GoPros in certain instances to show speed and it's just intercutting all the different shots to, you know, get the amount. You speed up the footage a little bit in certain instances where, you know, you want to make it look faster than it is. So in the narrow road, we actually have three simultaneous car chases going on at one time. And so we're intercutting between all of those. you have facial reactions, tight shots on steering wheels. It's, you know, to create a sense of intensity.
I can't wait to see it. He let me read the script before he started filming, so I was like, well, this I got to see once he films it.
So you're not really sending actors and actresses out into cars and saying, here, go 150 miles per hour and try to avoid the fire hydrant. No, actually hit the fire hydrant. Because, Scott, I could see you doing that. You'd probably have fun with that, yes?
I don't know. I'd not sure that'd be the kind of role I would be good in or whatever. I've kind of always been kind of more of the character. Like, even the role I play in Reconciler is kind of a little bit, I'd say it's a little bit character actor. For one thing, like I said, the premise in the movie, you know, me and these two guys were all locked in a room together. It's the two brothers who are estranged. One of the reasons why my character in Reconciler exists is not just because I wanted to act in this movie, although I'm someone who, you know, does like to be a ham and likes to act in the stuff that he writes. So it's very hard for me to get excited about something and spend time at a computer writing a story if I'm not going to at least, you know, poke my head in there as in like a cameo role or something like that. But you needed a character. My character's name is Ed, and what I think someone once told me this, Ed is kind of the film's linchpin from a writing standpoint. Mm-hmm. I needed somebody locked in the room with our two main reconcilerees, if you want to know that, the two people, who basically could tell not only them, but the entire audience, the story of what was going on. Mm-hmm. And I thought, okay, what third-party person makes sense? And I thought, well, maybe the reconciler has a reporter that's doing all these stories on him, and maybe he maybe he ticked the reconciler off, and so the reconciler decided to say, I'll show you, and threw him in with the current two reconciler victims. Mm-hmm. So my character really doesn't have much of a character arc, so to speak. He's very much, I guess you could say, the film's narrator or storyteller. He's basically Mr. Exposition, which, when you think about it, if you're going to put the writer, one of the writers of the film, in the movie, that's the perfect role for him to play.
Exactly.
So, especially if you like to talk as much as I do. So,
Sean, you've also worked for the Food Network and National Geographic Films.
A lot of, like I said, us filmmakers gotta have a day job too. So sometimes until we get regular. I mean, I've been in business with my own production company for, it'll be 28 years in May now, and working on my fourth film, but the films 2 through 4 have just been in the past, you know, a couple three years of that. And so to, you know, pay the bills, feed the family, I've done a lot of corporate and commercial and broadcast work. And I also have, as Scott mentioned, a twin brother who has his own production company as well. And so there are a couple of projects that Kyle, my twin brother, actually contracted with National Geographic Television and with the Food Network and a few others that he's called me in on, and we've worked on the projects together. It's just wide ranging. I've done corporate work for everybody from U.S. Bank to United Parcel Service as well. So, but, you know, all of that, you know, gives me continued, experience and the level that, takes it into my passion of actually doing the films. So, mm-hmm.
Yeah, and Caleb's not done with his producer work, I believe.
Right.
Yeah, what... You have another project where he will be the, I think it's executive producer?
For Caleb?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're continuing to reinvest funds, and so I'm able to, you know, help extend, you know, Caleb's legacy to name him as co-executive producer or sole executive producer on other films. And even during the time of those 27 years that I've been in business, I've written and have continued to write other screenplays. So, there's definitely a lot to choose from as I continue to ramp up. You know, my dream, as many filmmakers, is to, you know, be doing films full time. And so you got to have a library of stories and screenplays to do that with. And so, yeah, we'll definitely be naming him. In fact, I actually have a screenplay that I've started writing based on Caleb's life. And it's called, what is it called?
To be named.
Oh, no, this is the first time
I've heard named.
About it.
I have a name for it, but I'm working on that. But, yeah, and it just... there will be a film based on Caleb's life that, you know, ultimately will help show his heart and his heart for people, and that he loved God and he loved others. And, I want it to be an encouragement to the viewers as well.
Mm-hmm. Now, when we were talking before, you were talking about a different way of financing movies, I believe, where it was going to be more donor-based donations?
Well, yeah, I've done and will continue to do investor-based films. But one of the things being in the faith market is I've had people have seen my films, and they've been very encouraging, but also saying, yeah, can we donate? You know, we'd love to donate, because in some ways, you know, some people view it as definitely as a ministry to make the films like we're making. So their thought is, well, hey, I can, you know, could I donate to the cause? And of course, I didn't have a vehicle to do that, being investor-based films. And so this last October, I finally kind of felt the urging to go ahead and start an organization called Countdown Releasing, which gives people the ability to donate to a not-for-profit that will be continuing to produce certain titles and other films. So it kind of goes across the divide of, you know, investors can do, you know, what they're going to do with investing, but then donors can donate to a not-for-profit to, you know, bring titles to the screen as well.
Mm-hmm. Scott.
Yes.
I know that you have done a variety of things, written a variety of things. A lot of them have shown up in the church where you attend.
Right.
And you had one thing called Sanctuary Superheroes. Do you want to explain a little bit about what that is?
It's, to be honest with you, it's just something. It was kind of a, it was a series of skits that we had done. Me and my closest friend, Ben Neal, we were the only two who were in it the entire time. All the other characters ended up getting recast. We did like two every year for about 3.5 years. I decided to write 7 of them. There's this comedy show called Whose Line Is It Anyway?
Yep.
Okay. And they do this comedy sketch from time to time called Unlikely Superheroes, where they basically each come in and they each name each other and then have to act out their prospective superhero name. And every time I watched that sketch, I thought to myself, you know, this is the one sketch that kind of gets the audience's imaginations going a little bit more, because you kind of find yourself imagining, okay, what would that superhero look like? And of course, mm-hmm. the guys are all just acting out in their regular everyday clothes. So I decided to write a sketch, a skit for church that was inspired by that, but I wanted it with a little bit more planning out, mm-hmm. where people would wear masks and stuff. And I said, okay, I want to make up these character names very quickly because I want it to be somewhat reminiscent of Whose Line Is It Anyway? And the 4 character names that I came up with were Hymnal Guy, Baptism Boy, Captain Communion, and Offering Man. And I played Hymnal Guy myself, and my friend Ben played Offering Man. Baptism Boy, we recast once, and we had 4 different Captain Communions within the course of the history of this. The first one went so well that we decided to do them a couple more times. And I'll never forget when my friend told me that during the time we were doing the second one, a kid from the teen group whose parents didn't go to church came to church for the first time when we were doing this.
Just to watch that?
No. And he came in right in the middle of this, and he looks up. And what does he see on the platform of the church? 4 guys in capes and masks. And and it was like, oh dear, my son's in a cult. And we're like, no. This is just a church drama thing. This is a sketch. Don't worry about it. So it was kind of funny. But you know, it's one of the couple things that I've done. You know, a lot of the skits that I've written have been like short kind of. I mean, what Sean was talking about you know, stockpiling the war chest of ideas, so to speak. It's mm-hmm. something that it's one of the best things I've learned from him, because I mentioned this to you when we were talking last night. Reconciler, which is being, you know, re-released next month.
Yep.
It's a great film and I'm very proud of it, but we shot it back in June of 2014. It's been over 2 years since we filmed something else.
Yep.
And now I'm great. I love the fact that Sean has gone on to work with Xander, who he met because of Reconciler, and things are going to keep going. And Sean and I, we never intended on doing we live too far apart that everything that we do can be together. I mean, like, I'm working on a potential movie with another Christian filmmaker that's about the first 4 chapters of Genesis. Mm-hmm. So that might come to fruition at some point and stuff. So, but, you know, I kind of wanted to, there was a point where I was like, you know, not much is happening. And he was like, well, you know, if we haven't gotten anything greenlit right now, maybe you should write some more ideas down that you have, so that if one of our projects does get going, you can have other stuff ready to go in case any of those people who want to, you know, produce them or finance them says, what else do you have?
Yeah.
I was like, you know, I kind of never thought of that. So I've been working on some scripts in the meantime. I kind of have taken a little break here during the December season because I'm very busy as a entertainer.
Yes.
But now that January hits and I've got free time again, I'm going to probably start thinking about, okay, what else is up here? What else can I...
Yeah.
What else can I put on paper?
So. You guys were also thinking
about turning possibly the thing that you were mentioning, the superheroes thing, into a kids' television show. And but I'm also talking to a group right now about turning The Reconciler into a television series as well. So, and Scott very handily when I asked him to, wrote 10 episodes of the Reconciler series. So, yeah, you got to have stuff banked away for sure.
Where would something like that appear? Would that be ABC, NBC, or would you pick other networks or something like that?
It would be up to the distributor, actually.
Yeah.
I know they were actually talking about, you know, the growth of the online broadcasters, per se. You know, the Netflix has a lot of original series now. You have Hulu and Amazon Studios and, you know, a lot of, and they're actually getting Emmy nominations just like the network shows and have quite a following on a lot of their shows. So the distributor and finance group that I was talking to is actually looking at that venue for the series.
So today there's a lot more opportunity for people who do it well to get into this field as opposed to when there were just three networks.
Oh, very much. In fact, I think I was reading an article in Variety this last week that reported that there's, and maybe my numbers are wrong, but I could have sworn they said it was 433 scripted series right now are in production. Mm. And, you know, compared to 20 years ago when you had the big networks that were the only ones doing series, I mean, that's just exponential for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, Scott, you look like you're going to say something.
Well, one thing that, just to give you an idea as to we might be striking when the iron is hot, so to speak,
mm-hmm.
is one of the, I guess you could say, big wigs of faith-based media right now is Pureflix, the people who did God's Not Dead.
Yes.
Okay? A couple of years ago, they made a movie called The Encounter and then a sequel to it called The Encounter Paradise Lost.
Right.
Okay? They decided that it was something that would work as a series, and they started making a series that is of The Encounter that is exclusive to their website. In some ways, PureFlix.com is kind of turning into the faith-based Netflix in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And you can actually see Reconciler on there, for example. Yeah. And the funny thing is that when Sean had said, you know, we want to do a TV series or whatever, I was a little bit against it because it was kind of one of those things that I wasn't sure if there were that many ideas out of. I thought that how many different ways can you lock two people who can't talk in a room together? How many scenarios can you put them through? And I had actually written only one film sequel to it. And I was like, you know, I think we should do this film. And then finally, I don't remember exactly what the turning point was. But at some point, either Sean or my dad or something realized that I was not thinking outside the box like I normally do.
Mm-hmm.
And I just decided to see, you know, how many ideas could I do. And I finally said to Sean, I think the best that I could do here is maybe, you know, take the sequel idea that I've written as well as some other stuff and maybe make a couple of half-hour episodes. And this, mind you, this is before the Encounter series ever hit Pureflix, okay? And I finally said to him, after putting my thinking cap on, sometimes you just need to get the creative juices flowing.
Yep.
And I figured out a way to, you know, break up the idea I already had and come up with more. And I said, Sean, I think the best I'm going to do is like 10 half-hour episodes. And I don't know if that'll work, but should I start writing that? And he said, sure. Then Encounter comes out, and it turns out that's exactly the format they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing like 8 to 10 half-hour episodes.
Sure.
And I was like, okay, I just said half-hour episodes because I didn't think I could get any more out of them. But if that's good enough for the people who are doing these online series, then we might actually be onto something here.
Yeah. So. There used to be, I suspect it was long before your time, but there used to be a show on television called The Millionaire, where this unknown guy gave away $1 million to somebody, and they never knew who they got the money from, and the secretary or attorney to the millionaire was the one who would deliver the money to them. Well, the show was about, first of all, finding the person, giving them money, but then the rest of it was about what happened afterwards. So they had the basic premise of what they were doing,
right,
which in the case of what you're doing is to have them in a room.
Right.
And then it's what do they do afterwards that really made the story
right
interesting. So I imagine something like that.
Yeah. Well, some other idea. The problem is I can't talk about what the concept of the television show is without giving away a major spoiler about the movie. And we want
Don't spoil the movie.
Yeah, we want people to see the movie because it is one of those, like I said, we believe, you know, in writing actual stories, you don't hear the word spoiler used for Christian film very often.
Not often.
Yeah, and when Sean's film, our film has had several reviews that Sean has forwarded to me, mm-hmm. and when one of them included the word spoiler, I was like, yes, we did it. We're changing things. We're making some headway here, because I'm someone I'm a big film buff, and I tell people, there have been times I've watched movies that are of the mainstream, and people have said, you know, as a man of faith, how can you watch those? And I go, well, I kind of look at a movie that's full of junk, like an all-you-can-eat buffet, you don't have to eat everything. You know, look at the things that you like, and then try to ignore the stuff that's pretty much junk, and you kind of just, there's nothing worse than a good movie that could have been a great movie. Yeah. And, you look at it and you say, you know, this is great, but why couldn't they have done it without this? And the funny thing is that there were a few critics or a few reviews that actually referred to The Reconciler as the Christian version of Saw, which is a horror movie where two people are locked in a room, but it's a completely different concept. Yeah. So,
well, I mean, I love movies, too, and I watch all kinds of movies. And, I mean, I've seen good movies across a whole bunch of different genres. Mm-hmm. Including in the Christian sector of it. And I've seen some pretty bad ones out there. And Sean, you had talked about it earlier where you said that you have a movie that here you've got a character and then you develop a movie around them, as opposed to developing a plot and developing characters along the way. And I think too often we see, okay, yeah, let's make a Batman movie, and then we'll figure out what the plot's going to be. Oh, it'll be something that's been done 1,000 times before, just as a means to make money.
Yeah, we'll make all our money before word of mouth can kill us.
Right. And it's like, you know, we won't bother to use our creativity and imagination to do this. Yeah. We'll just throw it out there because we know people will come. And I think I've seen that in the Christian version of it, too, where they'll go, yeah, we'll have somebody who's heartbroken, something happens to them, and God will come into their life, bring some magical person in, and we'll do a lot of static, cliche dialogue, and it will work great. And then there have been some really good ones where there's been a lot of imagination and creativity. And this sounds exactly like one that has a lot of creativity and imagination to it. And I think that that's a challenge in any genre movie.
For sure.
You definitely want to grab the audience. That's one thing that I've... There's a lot of Christian films that I think have trouble getting going.
Yes.
And when you... I think one of the reviews that we had said, you know, when the shot pans to two people unconscious in a room, you start to think that bad things are going to happen. You know, we had a great cinema photographer on Reconciler named Kevin Hayes. Mm-hmm. And Sean, I think you said he came up with the opening shot of the film?
Yeah, he did. That's what a DP does. So.
Yeah, and it was an awesome shot. And I was like, I was like, man, this... You know, we did it. I wanted an opening shot. When I wrote the first draft of the script or came up with the concept, you very rarely hear the words "gripping from minute one" about a Christian film. And I wanted, I wanted a movie that was like, even though it was faith based, people would turn it on and be like, "Okay, you have my attention." Mm-hmm. So, and I think we did that. I think.
Just because we have a few minutes left. Sean, what's your advice for somebody who's trying to get their story told through a movie form? And for Scott, it looks like it's starting to work out for him, but for other people, what would you advise people on how to get noticed?
Are you referring more to writers or
for writers.
I just say write your passion, the other element too is that I had dreams of being a filmmaker. I'd started my production company doing corporate back in 1989, and I always felt that I, you know, wanted to do films and felt called to do films. And, you know, if you remember back in the 90s, I mean, that was before Tarantino and you know, all the film, you know, independent filmmaker guys of the 90s, you know, it was the studio system. And there's no such thing as really as an independent filmmaker. And it was kind of in 92, I was like, well, I don't want to move to L.A., you know, and start out. And I had, you know, just been married a couple of years, and the thought of, you know, moving to a new place and, you know, from the ground up was not very appealing to me. So I just started writing. I'm like, well, what can I do? And I said, well, just write. And so that's what I did. And my first script was terrible, full of cliches, and but I got it out of the way and learned from it. And the next story that I tackled was what actually became my first film. And but it was just one of those things where I got out there and just started writing. And I think one of the most important pieces of advice that I got was to find a group of people, other writers or other people that you trust to give you honest opinions of your work.
Yep.
Because you could write 10 screenplays and not be open to criticism, and you know, because they're all your babies, and you don't want people to give you, you know, insight or advice, and you'll have 10 terrible scripts. But if you open yourself up to people's opinions and people that you trust, you know, I remember there were certain people that I invited to, you know, give me advice on my script or give me their feedback, and they were like, oh, it's great. And I didn't ask them again to review another screenplay because I didn't want people to say it was great. I wanted them to give me their honest opinion. I wanted them to be critical of it. I wanted them to give me insights. And I think that's one of the most important things you can do as a writer to improve yourself. And to tell really great stories as you learn from those things. And it's not that you do everything that everybody says, but you take in what people say and you weigh it and you chew on it and you're like, okay, well, you know, what do I think of this, you know, harsh criticism or this or this or that? And in fact, one of my best reviewers early on was an ex-military guy who, you know, didn't pull any punches. I mean, he told me what he thought and he gave me respect at the same time, but I, you know, as some, you know, at first I was like, well, no, that's not the way that it should be. And yet you start to think about it and chew on it, and you're like, well, actually, he has a good point. So
yeah, I think every writer's first script is terrible. I know mine were. So I had a drama teacher who read one of mine and tore mine apart. And funny thing is, years later, when I did one film as an actor prior to this movie called Dark Disciple.
Mm-hmm.
And I can remember, she actually passed away recently, and she had actually come to see Dark Disciple and heard Reconciler was coming out, and I had mentioned something on Facebook about the two films, and then she forwarded it and said, one thing that this guy, this made my day when she did this, she said, one of the reasons why things are starting to happen for Scott is because he listened to more than just the kudos.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people just listen to the kudos. They don't want, they, like, if I just listened to the kudos, Reconciler wouldn't exist, because if I had not been able to give it to Sean to improve it, because sometimes, I think I mentioned this to you last night when we were talking, one of the things that I can't understand is the people who will never change the script. They will say, okay, the script has to be this way, this character has to be this character, you know, characters, their names, what they do, and sometimes maybe somebody has a better idea than you do.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And Sean is an example of somebody who has had better ideas than I do several times.
So. Yep. And we're going to end the show with, well, do you want to describe what we're going to watch? Because we're going to end
this.
This
is actually the featurette. You'll see both Sean and I on it.
It seems darker. It's darker. It's grayer. How would you like to sink your teeth into something real?
When you start talking about the grain of society, why does it always have to come back to God?
What? Where am I?
You can't report anybody missing for a full 24 hours.
I can't get the door open.
All right, we both woke up in here too, okay? All right, we don't know what's going on or why we're here.
Who would do something like this?
They call him the Reconciler.
Take some time to talk about how you got to this point. Once you work things out, I will let you out of the car.
Oh no.
I got you. Come on.
What is going on?
I don't know.
That's it. I'm getting out of here.
No, don't!
It's like we don't matter to you. Who do you think I fight for?
There was so much to lose. So little we could control about it.
But what I keep coming to over and over again is that I'm just not good enough.
The beautiful thing about God is that he is always there, bringing us in, like a real father would be.
I guess I view God working like a river. When a river gets blocked, it always finds a way to flow.
Jesus told me you were coming, and he loves you very much, and he wants you back.
Thank you to Scott and to Sean for being my guests, and thank you all for joining me. My name is Wayne Braverman. I'll see you next time on Celebrate Life.